So, Father, I just ask that you would open our hearts, our lives, that you would teach us again today your word. Help us, Lord, to be open. Let the anointing of God rest. Let it breathe upon us today. Let the word of God inspire us, Lord. And we need, Lord, I need you to speak through me. I need, Lord, your presence. I can't do this without you. And I ask, Lord, that you would enable all of us to hear what the Spirit has to say. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. So, this is a, you know, again, a really challenging part of Scripture here. But I like to go to 1 Corinthians and just deal with this a little bit more as we've talked about it in regards to this. And so, if we look at this, we're not taught about leadership very much. So it's easy to have a few misconceptions. Is that true? You know, that's not usually a class that we learn in high school, as Elliot shared. And we really don't understand the importance of leadership in our lives. And so we see this misconception that is there. But one of the things that I want to do is I want to focus on this, and I want us to dig into this a little bit more and understand this. So 1 Corinthians chapter 10 begins to open up some things for us, and I want to go also into chapter 11, just briefly. So if we can go there, and just read this. So it says, so whether you eat or drink or whether you do it all for the glory of God. And it says, don't give offense to Jews or Gentiles or the church of God. Verse 33 says, I too try to please everyone in everything I do. I don't just do what is best for me, because we realize that sometimes we do what's best for me, right? I do what is best for others, so that the many may be saved. It's important to see this, okay? So I want us to kind of just stay there for a second. If you can go back to 31. And I want you to notice what it says. We sometimes don't think we're leading when we're eating or drinking. Just normal day life. We don't think that we're leading. We're leading all the time, whether we believe it or not. Someone is looking at us. They're looking at how we're handling things, how we're handling our lives. We're leading. Even when we eat, when we drink, whatever we do. Whatever we do. It's even how we drive. You know, we're leading. We're leading. And I have this big old Tree of Life sticker on my truck, you know. So if I blow my horn at someone, you know, and then I pass them, I'm leading them to say, you know, don't go to that church. You know what I'm saying? So we have to always be careful that we are leading. We're leading. And sometimes it's not so much what we say, but it's what we do. And you see that. You see it here. Do it all for the glory of God. Now, why? If we really are followers of Jesus Christ, the reason we're not just interested in me, we're interested in the others, is because we want to see as many people come to an understanding or a relationship of Jesus Christ. And where are they going to see that? In us. So if we see this right here, and we unfold it a little bit more, verse 32, it goes on, verse 33, it goes on, and then it jumps right into chapter 11, and it says, and you should imitate me just as I imitate Christ. So every one of us are leaders. And if Christ is in us, we need to allow that to truly impact our lives. Now, do I always know what I'm doing? Do I understand that sometimes I've made mistakes and acknowledging those mistakes? Now, I've stood in this pulpit and apologized sometimes. I said, I've made a mistake, or I misspoke, or I want you to understand. You know, these are things that are important, because leadership is not perfection. So it's important for us to see this. But we're imitating. We're imitating who? Christ. And if Christ is in us, then that is how we are to lead from, and allow that to take place in our lives. And so you see that. But also another aspect of it that I would like to just kind of hit here. And the rest of the scriptures, not many, but the rest of the scripture, all from Hebrews chapter 11 and 12. So we're just going to stay there. But of course, you know the scripture. Without faith, it's impossible to please God because you must believe that He is and that He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. So if I'm imitating or if I'm seeking Him, there's a reward that comes with that. Without faith, it's impossible. So we must believe that He is and that He is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. I think we have that scripture. It is, it's up there. Right there it is. And it's, you know, it's important for us to see this challenge in our lives. It's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. We actually read that scripture last week as we were studying this. It says, humanly speaking, it's not possible. But with God, all things are possible. So I'm going to tell you this. By faith, I believe that every one of us can be leaders. I want you to see that. By faith, you can become one powerful leader. But also, for that to happen, there's misunderstandings, so I'm going to call them myths. Seven myths that we kind of get caught up in that hinder us from being effective leaders. So, the first myth here is leaders are born. Leaders are born. That is a misconception completely, totally. And we just have some examples here. We grow into it. Remember the scripture that we use as our theme scripture, which is 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It talks about, when I was a child, I behaved as a child, I understood as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. Let me explain this to you. When we're young, we need to be led by others, but when we get older, we have to make a decision to put away childish behaviors, childish ways of thinking, the misconceptions. We need to become mature. When I was a child, I thought as a child, I behaved as a child, but when I became a mature adult, I understood that I have influence. And what I do affects others. That I have responsibility. And I need to be aware of those things. And so we see that. We influence people all the time. Real leaders don't need positions or titles to lead. Do we? I mean, some people are really hung up on titles. You know, and sometimes when they go into a position, it's like that's the worst thing that could have ever happened. Is now all of a sudden they think they're the boss. You know, and it's the same thing with me. Sometimes people say, what would you prefer to be called? Well, Andrew. That's my name. That's what I would prefer to be called. You don't want to be called, no, I'm not really, I don't really play this pastor game that well. I don't like that. My wife would say that. You hear the name pastor more than you, like Renee sometimes, she says, Andrew, and then she says, pastor. And I turn. Is that true, baby? That's true. So, but I just want you to be aware of that it's not about leading. It's more about being. Being is the impact here, and when you truly are, things begin to change. We lead from this place. When we lead from this place of just really knowing that we are called by God to imitate Him, follow me as I follow Christ, people will follow you. They want to follow. They want to follow integrity and truth and love and joy and peace and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. They want those kind of things. And if they see that modeled, if they see that, so leaders are not born. They're made. How are they made? We're made in the image, in the likeness. And the more that we look into the perfect law of liberty and we see Christ in us, the hope of glory, that's when we truly lead. The second myth that we have is leaders can't make mistakes. I just made a couple of them today. First one is I got up. No, come on. Now that was a mistake. So it says here, if we believe we can't make any mistakes, we're done. All right? We leaders learn from their mistakes. We leaders learn. I like this idea of we leaders. We leaders is really the key word here. We leaders will make mistakes, but won't give up. We live in Southwest Florida, and there was this winter home that Edison had, which is not that far from here. And if you've ever gone there, and you've gone through his workshop, and you saw the light bulb that he has there, and just all of the inventions that he has, you know, and he tried over and over and over and over again. And, they said, you'll never get this thing down. He says, well, I just found another way that it doesn't work. Jerry, help me out a little bit. Can you turn off the lights here for a second? Aren't we thankful for all the mistakes that Edison made?
Yeah.
Ta-da! And now, we are not sitting in the dark because Edison didn't give up. Let there be light.
Pretty good timing. That's pretty good for you.
It's important for us to see that. So, truth. That's not how we learn success. That's how we learn. There's John Maxwell. He's a great leader and leads leaders. And he says, he wrote a book called Failing Forward.
Yep.
So if I'm going to make a mistake, I'm just going to make sure that I fall forward and learn from that mistake. Not let that mistake bind me up and hinder me, but letting it cause growth in my life. And so let me read to you, let's go on to the next. Let me read this to you. And I think that in some ways, I said that I was going to stay focused. So this is right after It's Impossible to Please God. We must please him. Okay, this is the next verse. It was by faith that Noah built up a large boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God. Now, let me tell you something. That had never been done before. And it looked like a total failure. As far as the world was concerned, Noah was an idiot. Why do you build something on dry ground and say that there's going to be a flood when there never was? I mean, this is the biggest mistake in all of history. And if you look all over the world today, all over the world, you will find remnants of a flood. It happened all over the world. I mean, you see it in every continent. You see it all over the place that this actually took place. But it says, who warned him about things that had never happened before. See, so sometimes as leaders, we're asked to do something. Well, that's never been done before. And we actually are not aware that God wants to do new things. Behold, I want to do new things. And so that's the case. We see that here. By this faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world, and he received the righteousness that comes from faith. Now, I've said this to you. This word here, condemned, is not really the proper. It is, he judged the world in the sense of saying, they don't know what they're talking about. God does. So am I going to honor the world, or am I going to honor God? And this is the challenge sometimes about leadership, is because the world looks at us and saying, look at these Christians. They're the biggest mistakes that ever. Look, they come to church. It's like a crutch. No, Jesus Christ is not my crutch. He's my life. And it's not a mistake to follow him. And this is what happens. God wants us to have a breakthrough in these areas. So let's go on to the next myth. Myth number three, leaders tell people what to do. Really? How many of you like for people to tell you what to do? Leaders show by example. It's more important that you see the example. It's not what I say, it's what I do. Leaders look out for the we. It's simple. It is if I see a need or a situation, it's not I have to tell you, I have to show you. This would be the best way for us to move forward. They get their hands dirty. Honestly, they get their hands dirty. You wanna hear some dirty stories? Stinky stories, you know, I mean, it's crazy. You know, stuff happens here all the time. Weird stuff happens here. And so I think it was about 5 weeks ago. Do I really want to share this story? 5 weeks ago, somebody had diarrhea in the bathroom. So bad, it was nasty. So somebody comes to me, of course, and says, what are we going to do about it? And I knew at that very moment that no one really wanted to touch that stuff. No one really wanted to mess with that. So guess what I did? Is I got the mop, I took care of it, I cleaned the whole thing up. It was all over the floor, all over the toilet, everywhere. And I cleaned it up. You know why? Because that's what leaders do. Every time that I walk into this building, I walk through the parking lot, there's not a time that I don't find some plastic bottle on the floor, some cigarettes, some light beer, or, you know, people hang out, you know, homeless people hang out and they sit on the bench and they drink beer or whatever, throw it in the bushes. Guess what? I cleaned it up. What else are you going to do? That's what leaders do. You know, again, we were at this wedding, and it's like I can tell you some of these guys' names. Alexander, Patrick, Jerry. These were the ones that served us. I know them because I talk to them, and I show them that they're important and significant, that they're not just there to serve, but they're there. So I met a guy from Jamaica, I met a guy from Bulgaria, I met a guy, you know, just from all over. And Patrick was another guy that served us. And so it's just knowing and that we care. That's what this is talking about. Leaders serve. And if you are a leader, then you're going to begin to understand that that's a calling. It's not a burden. What does Jesus say? He says, if you want to be great in the kingdom of God, be a servant. I didn't come, Jesus said, I didn't come to lord it over you. I've come to serve you. That's what he is all about. Let's go on. So by this fourth myth is leaders must know where they're going. Do you know how to get there? Isn't this the most famous scripture of all in regards to Abraham, the father of faith? Let's read it. It was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave home and go to another land that God would give him as an inheritance. He went without knowing where he was going. Duh. So often we do not step in leadership roles because we don't know completely the destination. I'm going to tell you something. If where you are is not good, it's probably wise to get up and move. Even though you might not know where you're going, it is better. There's a story in the Bible about these lepers. The city of Jerusalem was surrounded, and the enemy was trying to besiege the city, and they were trying to starve these people out. And of course, the lepers were not allowed to live in the city, so they were living outside the city, but the people in the city took care of the lepers. All of a sudden, the food disappeared. And of course, the lepers were dying. And they said, if we stay here, we'll die. If we go, we might die. So what do we do? So they got up and left. And as they were leaving, God used them, and I don't know, the shoveling of their feet or something, they made such a ruckus that the army actually thought that there was a multitude, and all of these people fled and took off, the whole army, and these lepers go, look at all the food that's out here. They ate, and then they knocked on the gate and said, hey, the army's gone, and there's plenty of food for everybody. It's because they chose to step out, not really knowing what was going to happen. Not knowing. Abraham had to step out, not really knowing where he was going. Let's look at some of these examples here. Just a couple of myths that we have here. Leaders cast vision for the we. We need others to help. We leaders rely on others, while me as loners. Again, it's important for you to see this. When there's two or three of you together, it's not going to always, you don't always know the details. But together, God will show you things. God will reveal things to you. And the destination will become clearer and clearer. And I want to say something here. Our destiny and our destination is very clear. It's Jesus Christ. Our hope is in Him. Our mission is to get closer and closer to Him. And if I'm hanging out with others that have that same, even though I might not know exactly how to get there, if I'm hanging out with others that are doing that same thing, I'm going to get there. That's important. This is the body of Christ, that we work together. Truth. Leaders need to know who they are going with. And that's why it's important for us to journey together, to be together. Let's go on to the next myth. Let me read the scripture to you here. We'll go on. This myth right here. Leaders are in the front and visible. Really? We are leaders everywhere. The part holding up a building are not always seen. Do you see my bone structure right now? No, you don't. That's more important than actually what you see on the outside. My heart, my liver, my lungs, you don't see it. Right now, before the service even started, there were people who were here serving me. There were people last night preparing things. There were people who prepared all during the week to make this happen. There's the sound guys. They have been helping me with this information. All of this stuff. All the people that you don't see right now in the nursery that are taking care of the kids, you don't see them. They're leading. They're leading. And they're very significant and important. And it must be understood. Me-focused leaders only act when being watched. We're not putting on a show. If you want a show, then watch television, because it's not real. But if you want to see real life, then hang out with people that are choosing to follow Jesus Christ. We influence people more often without using words. You know, honestly, it's our actions that make it clear. The truth in this, you can lead from the front, the back, the side, just about everywhere. And I'm going to say something to you. If you don't think that you're important, you're deceiving yourself. You are significant. You're important. And when you diminish what God wants to do through you, that is not a good place to be. Because God believes in you. That's why he has you here, right here in this community, right here at this church. That's why he wants you to be a part of it. Let's read the scripture. How much more do I need to say, which would take long to recount the stories of faith? Remember Gideon? What was he doing? He was hanging out. He was afraid. He was not visible. He was not some important person. He actually said, you got the wrong guy. I'm the least, if you remember, the least, the littlest, the last. You have the smallest tribe. I'm not a significant person. You got the wrong guy. You know, so Barak, Samson, David, Samuel. Remember, how did Samuel? Samuel was just a little kid, right? And he heard the voice of the Lord. And God began to speak to him. And he grew into becoming a leader. But he didn't start out as David. How did David start out? Was he visible? Let me tell you how visible David was. David was so invisible that when Samuel came to anoint the next king, Jesse, his daddy, didn't even think it was important to have him there. He had all the other brothers, and David was not even in the picture. You know what he was doing? He was taking care of the sheep. Right? He was just taking care of the sheep, and so the first son came, the second, none of these. You know, and remember what God said? He says, man looks at the outward appearance, but I look at the heart. And so why was David chosen? Because he really was invisible in some ways. But God made him visible. And it's important to see that. It says here, by faith these people overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice. They received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weaknesses were turned to strength. Oh, I'm weak. You betcha. God can take your weakness and turn it into strength. They became strong in battle, but the whole armies to flight. Women received their loved ones back again from the dead. I mean, the story goes on. And it also goes on and talks a little bit more about this and says, some of them didn't survive. Some of them didn't make it. But they led even to the point of death. It's important for us to see that. Let's go on to the next myth. Okay, so here it is. All these people earned a good reputation because of their faith, yet none of them received all that God had promised, for God had something better in mind for us, so that they would not reach perfection without us. Do you notice the idea of even here in the scripture in Hebrews, it's saying, don't get caught up in just me. Understand that what God wants to do is impact the we, the us, all of us together. And that's important to see here. Let's go on. The sixth myth, leaders have to make all the decisions. Really? I don't make all the decisions. I hardly can make any decisions. Because it's easier for others to trust them. Leaders trust others to share their knowledge. Leaders have and use specialty experts when planning. Me focused leaders don't ask questions. It's important that we allow others to influence us. I'll give you a little word that God gave me many years ago. And this is a word about faith and about denominations and about different belief systems a little bit. And this is what he said to me, Andrew, you need to allow streams into your life so a river can flow. What does that mean? He spoke this to me. He said, Andrew, if you hang out with the same people that think the same way do you, process the same way you do, believe the same way you do, then you'll have a stream. And that's fine. But if you want a river, you know what happens with streams? Streams run into a river. It's streams that turn into rivers that turn into the ocean, right? So in a sense, what God was saying to me is, Andrew, hang out with others. It opened up my mind that others are genuine, even though their theology might be a little different than mine, even though they might see things a little different than me, they are. If they're genuinely following Jesus Christ, I can learn something from them. So allow streams. I say this all the time. There's only really one church in Naples. But look at us. There's not another Andrew here. And there's not another Betty here. There's not another Joe. There's not another Eric. But all of us are human beings. So there's not a bunch of churches out there. There's really one church. There's one Lord, one baptism. So we need to understand this. Truth is, leaders let others make most decisions and focus on their decisions. The decision I had to make was to let others into my life. Not to throw them off the bridge. I don't know if you ever heard that story, but there was these two guys who were theologically discussing things, and they were walking across the bridge, and they agreed on this, they agreed upon Jesus Christ, they agreed upon the Word of God, they agreed on this, and then all of a sudden there was something that came to disagreement, and they were fighting with each other, and they're about to throw each other over the bridge. Instead of enjoying the journey together, on most things they agreed, on a couple of things they didn't. Why? Not just have liberty and charity and love. On the fundamentals, we can't. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, you can't change my mind on Jesus Christ. He is the Son of God. You can't change my mind on the Word of God. It is solid, secure. And you can't change my mind on being born again. You must be born again. You know, these are fundamentals. But on some of these other things, we argue about stuff, it's crazy. Let's move on to the last one. Everyone say, last one. Man, I can't wait for this thing to be over. Myth. There's only one leader. We can't lead if we stick back and watch. We have separate responsibilities. We reach more with different styles. When we see something missing, we can step up. I'm going to tell you something. Often this happens to me. People come to me and say, I think this would be a great idea, Andrew. You should do it. You know, the reason God laid that on your heart is because he inspired you to do that. And so he probably wants you to step up because you're noticing something. See, leaders notice something. If there's something missing, how many of you see some things missing at Tree of Life? Come on. Yeah, well, let me see your hands. Come on, raise them up. You see some, you know what? You're the leader that is supposed to step up to fill that missing part. Now all of a sudden the hands go down. Because we don't want that responsibility. I think Tree of Life could do this better. Step up. Step up. Well, I might strike out. Okay. then you'll know exactly how I feel sometimes. See, as a leader, honestly, you will make mistakes. But mistakes are not final. They're not failures. And we need to learn to allow those things to take place. The truth, with leaders, there's always room for more. There's room for one more. There's room for you. So if we just take Hebrews chapter 11 and we read the whole thing in context, then this is how it ends. And I want to kind of end this with this as well. So if we can go to the next scripture. So this is how it ends. And before we read that, let's go back and just kind of capture some of these thoughts. We are overmanaged and underled. Do you understand what that means? People are trying to manage us. Can I say I can't manage you? I can't. I don't want to. I have no desire. Because I believe with all of my heart that the Holy Spirit wants to lead you into all truth. So my job is to help you understand that the Holy Spirit wants to guide you and lead you into all truth. And that's very important. That's the reason the Holy Spirit was sent. That's the whole reason, so every one of us are not led or managed by a church, by a pastor, but we're led by the Spirit. That's very important. Most people don't see the difference between managing and leading. And I'm going to tell you, it's night and day. Managers are just kind of like, they're told what to do. Leaders believe what they're doing. If you're told not to sin, what good is that? But if you believe you shouldn't sin, that's totally different. That's the idea here. And that's the struggle. We focus on doing things right, but rarely do we focus, make sure we are doing the right thing. That's the difference between management and leadership again. You see it. I hope I do the right thing. I hope I do the right thing. Let's see it. God wants to change us. Be encouraged, me, we, to see the leader in me and in you. So let's end with this scripture. Since, read all of this, about all of these leaders, about Gideon, about Barak, about Samson, Samuel, David, Abraham, Noah. We read all this. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, or such a great cloud of leaders, we're surrounded by great leaders. Let me just throw this crazy idea. You're surrounded right now by great leaders. I could just walk through this group of people. You've hung in there when it seemed impossible. You didn't give up on your marriage. You took care of your grandkids when your daughter did some stuff that wasn't right. You know, you're dealing with things all over the place. Stella, you're a leader, and it's an honor to serve with you. John, it's an honor. Christy, it's an honor. I mean, I could just go through this congregation. And often we shrink back instead of embracing that. We are surrounded. Yeah, up in heaven we see it, but we're also surrounded by great leaders. If we would just have a little bit more respect for one another. It says here, therefore, since we're surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight. Let us get rid of every myth, of every excuse of why we can't be leaders. Let's get rid of them. And especially the sin that is easily trips us up. And let us run. Let us go, even though maybe we don't really know where we're going completely. But we do know where we are right now is not where we should be. Maybe right now, today, you recognize it's more about me. Today, you could make it about me. And realize that you have influence and the ability to make a difference. It doesn't matter if we're not the biggest, the smartest. doesn't matter. If we got all our dots in a row, doesn't matter if we have no money in the bank. Those things are our excuses. If you start trusting in Him and letting Him work through you, He will take you to places you've never dreamed of. We need more leaders. The misconception is that you don't think you are one, but you be one. Will you step up? Will you step up today? So, of course, the first thing I'm going to tell you right now is that if you haven't surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, that's the first step of being a leader. Matter of fact, you'll say, well, I don't really know all the stuff that's going to happen to me. Yes, you don't know. But one thing you do know, where you are is not the best place. Matter of fact, it's a place of confusion and death. And if you stay in your sin, sin leads to death. But His life leads to eternal life. So you leave where you are and you come to what He has accomplished for you on the cross. That's your destiny today, is to lead yourself first. So if you're here, if you just bow your heads for a moment, if you're here today and you have not accepted Jesus Christ, if you know that you have tried to manage your sin. So we're not into management. We're into leading, conquering, overcoming. And in the name of Jesus, sin can be conquered. And you need to lead yourself to accepting Him, believing in your heart, speaking it forth out of your mouth. So if you're here today, let me just see your hand and say, I want to lead myself in this area. I want to step up into leadership. I want to conquer sin today in the name of Jesus. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see those hands. Anybody else? Come on, this is a great, you're leaders, every one of you. First one we have to lead is ourselves. Leading ourselves. You know, one of my favorite scriptures is, we were once lost, but God has taken us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Lead yourself out of the dark into His marvelous light. Let's stand together. And those of you that raised your hand, take the next step. You might not know exactly where you're going, but the first step is just to come. Come to the cross. Stand right here with me. Just come. Just come. Stand right here at the cross. While that's happening, James, can I prophesy to you? You're a leader. God wants you not to let others manage you, but He wants you to lead. God has anointed you to lead. Come up here and we'll pray for you just for a second. You shouldn't be managed because you're a leader. And others have tried to do that. You need to know from this day forward, God is asking you to step up. You're doing a great job leading yourself, your family. He actually wants you to step up a little bit more in this area of leading. Father, I just ask for your anointing to rest upon him today. Let him know without any doubt that you are the source of life. Let him imitate you. I'm not calling him out to embarrass him. Lord, I'm calling him out because I see the call of God clearly. In Jesus' name. Say this to all of you. I see greatness in you. Do not let someone steal it from you. Don't let someone rob you from you. Don't quit managing your life. Lead. Be a leader today. And you will see powerful things take place in you. Quit trying to manage your sin, your shortcomings. Come out of them in the name of Jesus. And lead your life and lead others into victory. You know, this is what it's all about. And I know that there's excuses that we can make. We got some awesome people right here. Come on, anybody else? We got those of you that raised your hand. Come on. I'm gonna call you, lead you out. Every one of us, put your hand on your heart. I believe that you are my source of life. I perceive and understand that you are the one that has complete victory over every area of my life. Today I choose to let you lead me into victory, into forgiveness, into healing, truly overcoming. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the elders come just be there to pray with you if you need prayer. Thank you so much for being here today. Did we get rid of some misunderstandings today? Did we also step up today, from this day forward, be very careful, sensitive, that when you begin to see things like management, trying to manage things, I want you to shift into being the leader that God desires for you to be. You are to lead. You're not the tail, you are the head. You're above, not beneath. And you need to know today that He believes in you. And so do I. And the Word of God declares that. Greater to you. And since we're surrounded, you're surrounded by some great leaders here, you're surrounded by some great leaders right next to you. I want you to turn to someone and say, I believe that you're a great leader. And I want you to have a blessed Sunday afternoon. Those of you that would like to come tonight at 6:06 and want a little more understanding about spiritual gifts, about your personality, come hang out with me. God bless you. And remember, these guys are here to pray with you. Have an awesome Sunday afternoon.